Hello, 4 o'clock. Welcome to the week three update. Mike Amore here, or the great Mike Amore, I should say. Let's take a look at some of your work from this Sunday. We have here a middle game position between Navaneeth and Andrew, and this game ended in a comical way. Comical for Navaneeth, who actually did a little dab after the game, which is very funny. And poor Andrew suffered a defeat, but it was a very instructive one, nevertheless. Anyway, here in this position, Black played a nice move. Black took this knight that was in the corner and hopped it out to c2, which is usually a great idea, because when you take a rook in the corner, very often the knight that does the taking gets stuck in the corner. So I give him Andrew full credit for taking it out. But there was a bit of a tactic going on here, and I'm wondering if you guys could pause the video and find it for me. Okay, give a pause. I'm going to have some tea. Okay, the move is, look at every check and capture. Knight takes g4, check. Ouch, that's a check and a capture. And the reason it's so strong is, you know, if you don't accept the knight and move the king, you know, the knight may take in the center, meaning your king may end up here, and it can be really bad. If you do accept the knight, there's this queen h4 check idea. And this is really, really powerful. You have to be very careful where you put your king. You go to g2, you could get hit with bishop e4. If you go to g1, the queen just takes the knight, and Black's position is so strong here simply because of the placement of this king. Be extremely careful, in these positions. Watch those checks and captures. Let me fast forward a little bit, however. I want to take you to this position here. So Navaneeth had made a tremendous comeback here in this position, but he's still completely losing. He's in big, big trouble, but he managed to survive. In this position, I wrote on the back of my notation pad, because I was playing horribly against Ivan. Ivan kicked my butt. But I wrote something to Andrew, and I said, pawn wedges on the sixth rank near the enemy king, blah, blah, blah. Here it is. And I just said to him, look, be careful, because any check on this back row could be really, really dangerous. And he said, yeah, I see it, I see it. And he did. Except in this position, he ended up taking on e6. The rook takes back, and there's a knight hanging here on d5. Or is there? You see what he did wrong? He took the knight on d5, and now he gets mated. Rook e8. What do? You only have one move, unless you want to give your queen away. King a7, and then Navaneeth simply played rook takes rook, check. If king takes rook, queen takes pawn, you get crushed. Why? Let's go back. Please remember these things, my friends. Look at the knight on d5. Normally, his idea is very good. There's a bishop protecting a minor piece, so we give up the rook for two minor pieces. That's usually a very effective way to play, but again, look at the tactics. Rook takes, the knight is untouchable. Black, believe it or not, still has a bit of an edge here, but you're going to have to manage to get your king out of trouble and then activate these pieces. But once you take the knight, it's curtains. He just simply missed that, you know, after the rook trade, the game is over. Okay, very, very, very instructive. Okay, let's talk about how we got to these middle games. We were discussing the center counter defense. And in the center counter, there is this funny option for Black that when white takes the pawn, that we don't have to immediately take with the queen. It's become very popular again, knight f6. If you're interested in playing this with Black, I took a picture of a book by Grandmaster Smeerden, who wrote Smeerden Scandinavian. He did a ton of work on this knight f6 move. Okay, so what if white decides to play classically, puts a pawn in the middle of the board? And their attitude is basically, hey, look, you're playing the black pieces. You're not supposed to forget the color of your uniform. If you think you can just give white a pawn this early in the game, you're out of your mind. But Black says, yeah, you might be right, but you have to deal with my bishop, this bishop to g4 line. And when this hits the board, White has a lot of options. They can check with the light square bishop. They can block with the light square bishop. They can block with the knight. But the move we looked at was pawn f3. And after pawn f3, bishop f5, again, white has a number of options here. But one of the ones that gives black the most fun is when they try to hold on to everything with c4. And now black plays e6. And here it becomes a debate whether or not white should take all these pawns. The computers like to do it. So the computer is going to grab this pawn on e6. The humans, on the other hand, after knight c6 is played, better be very careful if they take the last pawn. And this is the position we looked at in class. Black must take. And then do a little assessment here. It's an interesting position. Black has three of their four minor pieces developed. That's a plus. Don't forget, you're down two pawns. But in return for the two pawns, your fourth minor piece, this bishop down here, in this line very often comes out with a check. And when that happens, you see the queen is flexible, and then both rooks are going to come to central files. There has to be compensation here. As a matter of fact, the computers that I've looked at, according also with the grandmasters, say that black is at least equal in this position. So knight e2, believe it or not, is the move that Ivan played against me. He got a great position. And I think Chris George played it against Fred. So kudos, guys. You guys found the best ways to play. And I messed up. I gave a check here on b4, but the correct move is to play knight to b4. Please pay attention to this because it's such a cool and instructive position. After knight b4, it seems that the most dangerous check is c2 because that's going to win in this position. It's going to win the rook in the corner, but that's not the reason why black is playing that move, knight to b4. Because if you try to protect the c2 square, for example, by playing knight a3, you're going to lose the game because you get hit with the other check, knight to d3. And you'll notice the knight on d3 covers the f2 square, which means the white king is coming to the middle of the board, or you're giving up your queen with white. In either case, you lose. Once the king comes to the middle, we throw in this free check. Why not? We develop the piece. It also opens the e8 square for the rook. These are all themes from this opening. So I know Sophie plays this opening as black, and I think Ben P is picking this up. So you know what, guys? Not a bad line to learn. You block the check with knight to c3, and then you get hit with queen takes d4. Black is completely winning. It turns out after this knight to b4 move, that a move that white can play here is knight to g3. And on the surface, it looks like a really bad move because it allows knight c2 check, king f2. And I love this position. Look at the two kings. Stare at the two kings for a minute. Like, how often or how many openings do you know after move 10? And black didn't even play their 10th move, that both kings are on f2 and f7. Very, very strange position. But here, white's intention is not to take the rook in the corner. This is going to turn out a little tough for black because after knight takes f5, you'll see that, again, the two kings are on those sister squares. The problem is white's pieces are going to flood out a little bit quicker. Problem, knight in the corner. This is a theme you have to know about in chess. If your knight is going to hop a couple of times to go into a corner to take a rook that hasn't moved, make sure you're getting something for that besides the points. Because here, you're going to leave white with one extra minor piece, and those minor pieces are going to get out very quickly in this position. So taking that rook is not black's intention. Their intention is to take on d4. That's the idea. And then I'll show you a couple of more moves. White will ditch a pawn to open this square. You see how that square opened? And if you accept, then they'll play bishop e3 to cover the diagonal to the king. Queen d6 protects the bishop in case the knight moves. And now watch this, simple check. And all the fireworks come to a halt. after these trades, and you get some kind of dryish, equalish kind of position. Is equalish a word? I'm not sure. All right, but you guys got the idea? Let me show you a couple of more positions, and then we'll call it a day. Okay, let's run through the moves again. E4, D5, take, knight F6, D4, bishop harasses big mama, pawn F3, bishop F5, there's the greedy line, C4. C4, we offer a second pawn, they take, develop the third minor piece, they take. This one we better take. You can memorize this stuff. King takes F7. And now, again, I showed you the best move was knight to E2, but here a lot of people play the move bishop to E3. And this gives black some chances to have some fun. Namely, because of bishop to B4 check, they block with the knight. And here I know Errol and Sophie both played rook to E8. And if king F2, by the way, black is completely winning. You just sacrifice the exchange. The king takes, and then if you happen to remember this far, and you can remember this gorgeous bishop to c2, that's right. Pause the video and try to remember why bishop c2 is crushing. And it really is. But there's other ways for white to go wrong here. They can simply protect the bishop with the queen, but that does not protect the pawn here. I think Sophie continued with knight takes d4, getting her pawn back and getting the knight very dangerously close to the white king. And then the junior Feldman played bishop to e2, and he walked right into a tactic. Rook takes e3. And that pretty much sealed the game, because if the queen takes, knight c2 check was really a crushing move. Okay? All right, let's move on to another game. All right, let's finish up with a position from Jared and Ben, because Jared played a pretty nice idea in gambit chess. So let's, again, I hate to bore you, but let's go through the moves one at a time again. So here's where black tries to take back with the knight, or just play for activity, d4. You remember what to play? Bishop to g4 is the line we looked at this time. Pawn f3. Bishop f5, c4, and e6. And again, white doesn't have to accept all these pawns. If they do take, we develop another piece. They take the last pawn in the chain. King takes. And here Jared used an idea in chess where we say, you know what? I have two extra pawns here. So rather than struggle to hide my king and deal with all this pressure, I'm going to play bishop to d3 here and just tell Ben, look, I'm going to give you a pawn back. And, you know, how do you deal with that, you know, once the pawn is given back? Because your king is on f7. So I like his idea a lot. The problem is, though, the black pieces came too fast. Bishop to b4 check. Remember that idea. Accelerating your development with a check, it's pretty much a free move in the game. The check was blocked with the knight. You have to be careful. You know, if you block something with the bishop, this bishop here might hang. And then you get hit with rook e8 check. So you see how fast the black pieces flow into the game. And sometimes I'm afraid to show you guys these positions because it looks like black is having so much fun that you want to play the opening too. It doesn't always work out this way. You have to do your homework. But in this game, and I'll end the video here, I just wanted to give you some samples of your work, which was really good. Jared played king to f1, and Ben took the pawn on d4. And much later in the game, Ben ended up getting a winning position, but I think he had one here earlier. Instead of taking with the knight, you have to look at the move queen takes d4. And tactically, it works. And I think he may have not liked the idea that that bishop is hanging on f5, but it's really not. So you can pause your video to see how black gets the material back. And you would just simply, what? Trade the queens. Knight must take. And now simply rook e1 check. Okay, and I'm saying simply like I know what I'm talking about. You know, trust me, with the clock ticking, I miss this stuff too. But after king f2, rook takes d1. This is kind of a cool rook because temporarily it's pinning two minor pieces. But this position is pretty good for black. Again, the kings are on those sister squares, but it's black this time that clearly has the pull. All right, I don't want to make this too long. It's just a good look at the kind of work we did in class. Just remember the ideas. Watch for the pawn wedges on the sixth rank. Watch for developing with a check, you know. If your king is on f7, but your pieces are really active, you probably have compensation. All right, my friends, great work. I'll see you Sunday.